Do that thing. Hey.
Definitely gotta get.
Get loose.
What up, it's your boy Go DJ.
And it's your girl Maddie D.
And this is the plug you heard.
You plugged in right now. This is theplug.com.
Yes, sir. We got a special guest in the building.
What up, y'all?
We all pretty much special guests in the building. We here live at the Strand right now.
With the green, with the green wall, you know what I'm saying?
I mean, it must be a different color.
We don't know what color this is right now.
We see green.
Yeah. Oh, no. That's funny. We got Troyman in the building.
What's up, you guys?
Whoop, whoop.
This is your first time in Providence?
Yes, first time in Rhode Island.
Welcome.
And I came through Boston. That was my first time in Boston.
In Boston, too?
Yeah. Oh, wow.
We got out of Boston, though, pretty fast.
Yeah.
It's not far from here. It's like 40
hour.
Minutes.
Yeah, it was an hour with the traffic, but it wasn't too bad.
It's 40 minutes when I'm driving.
She drives like a Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Welcome to This Is The Plug. So tell everybody who doesn't know a little bit about yourself, where you're from.
Troyman is that energetic ass kid from Oakland, California. Well, I was born in San Francisco, raised in Oakland. That knows the order he keeps getting. We got to keep going up, but we still try to hone into that energetic, you know, childlike side every now and then. So, or kind of reminding people, you know, to just live at this point. So, and we figured out how to do it in rhythm. So, you know, it's caused us to make music and expand our talents to everything from, you know, making beats and, you know, I'm an actor.
We do it all.
Ultimately, yeah, that's who Troyman is. I like to look at myself as not necessarily a hero or a role model, but the closest big brother to rap that we probably gonna get.
Nice.
Like Cole and Kendrick kind of take that role, like, without saying it, but I feel like with me being an older brother, it's kind of natural for me to take the actual spoken title, you could say. So I don't mind it either. It's cool.
Yeah.
Let's do it.
Watching the show, you were actually one of the people that stuck out to me the most because you do have that star quality. Right. So I think it's really dope.
I like the comparison to Will Smith.
That's my dog.
Will Smith, if he made trap. I like that comparison.
You know what I love about Will? Like, Will can drop a record at any given time.
Still to this day.
And we're gonna listen to it.
He had a show for his birthday.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That was crazy.
It was nuts.
Yeah.
It was nuts. One thing I love about him too, like I love the way certain entertainers, not even just artists, have this notion of truly knowing how to tap in on reinventing themselves. Will is definitely one. Of course, you know, he lives in the acting realm, but to hop from doing Bad Boys to even consider being the genie from Aladdin.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? That just to show you where his range truly extends to is astonishing. It's admirable.
He's constantly challenging himself, which makes him
a
superhuman.
Makes him so dope.
Yeah. Right.
Exactly.
Him, Beyonce, I feel like they're like superhumans.
So to be the trap Will Smith, first off, to be compared to Will Smith in any light, we're going to take it. T.I. said, I have a way of like kind of putting sugar in the medicine. Which I kind of feel like being exposed to Will as long as I have been, it's definitely probably a lot of it's been taken up by him. He has a way of kind of telling us stuff that we need to hear, but in the best ways possible versus it being so brute. I feel like that's just, you know, receiving it from him, I feel like that's the reason why I kind of want to put it out that way too.
Yeah.
You know? So it's important. That was a dope compliment, man.
And I seen like something on the Red Table Talk. It was like he's 50, but his biological age is 36.
Yeah.
So that just makes sense, you know.
It's a couple artists or entertainers rather. I feel like don't age, and that's in the physical sense, but also in the they're wise mentally, but. Like exactly what I was speaking on earlier, just being able to tap into your youth, they always have that avenue open for them. Will Smith is, you know, one of those people. Pharrell, Mm-hmm. You know, it's one of those people. It's a lot of people, of course, who have been in the industry, you know, for eons, but the list can go on and on.
Yeah. Now we got
two perfect examples.
Yeah,
we got two perfect examples, though.
You know what I'm saying?
Appreciate it.
Pharrell's pretty much like Benjamin Button, though. It's a little weird.
It's unfair. It's unfair when you think about it. You're like, yo, what do you take? Like,
what,
do
you, what type of vitamins are you on?
Are you vegan? You gotta be vegan. You just gotta be
He is vegan.
He is. It makes sense. He's probably been vegan for a minute, though.
Yeah.
That's a difficult decision, but if you got the tenacity to stick to it, major props to you, because I see steak and I'm like, yo, it's going down. I'm telling you.
Man.
Oh, my God.
Oh, man. But, all right, going back to how long you been doing music?
Wow, music, man. Honestly, I've been doing music. Okay, let's put it this way. Music's been in my life my entire life. Mm-hmm. They got documented stuff of me, they as in my family, when I was like four, just rapping different stuff from Tupac to, my stepfather was an artist, like, so I would go to him in the studio a lot at like 6 and 7. I took it serious at 13. I'm 27 now.
Same age, we out here,
92. Yeah, 92.
I'm
93,
baby.
Yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am. So roughly 14 years. Yeah, I definitely took it serious at 13. Once, it took like 3 years for it to really start to kick in. You know, after a while, you give your couple tracks out when you first start off, you get your feedback. But the feedback I was getting back then was pretty dope. A lot of people were saying I was ahead of my time, and I knew I needed to slow down because I was so young and I didn't make that transition into being a man yet. Yeah. Which is where they needed to accept me. We've all seen the transition from, you know, Bow Wow and Lil Romeo and people that we respected as kids, but you
Chris
know,
Brown's the only one who's done it successfully.
No, he made it. He did great too, because he was a dope kid, you know, but he's still dope now. I
mean, yeah.
He a thug now. The R&B Tupac, right? You know, I like to call him that.
So, oh, facts.
Yeah, it's pretty accurate.
So, coming doing music for so long and coming from a background, you said your stepfather also was an artist. Mm-hmm. What is it now, you know, as far as you've come in music, doing so much in a short time span, what is it that you want your legacy to look like or to be in the future?
I feel like I definitely wanted to, I want ultimately what everybody takes from my art is that I'm going to be expressive more than I'm going to be politically correct or trying to be. That I will express myself. I feel like a lot of the times we kind of close the door on that. We just tell the artist to just give us art. And we don't necessarily look at how they or what they put into it that makes these people appreciate it. Coming from that like lineage, I feel like it was big shoes to fill because they were signed with Tupac's label.
Oh, that's crazy.
Which was, yeah, I thought was super dope. Never met Tupac, of course. They did.
Yeah.
But throughout the journeys of them kind of getting booked studio sessions and stuff like that, like I would just go with my stepdad, you know, my mom would work late nights. And he had to babysit, but he wasn't trying to sit at the house. Cool. You coming with me? So, and you know, here we are as a result of that. Looking at the music they made, they were gangster rappers. So, you know, I was always exposed to like the shit that they, you know, were involved in and did. But, you know, I had a choice at a young age to let that be my reflection or to overcome it into something, you know, completely bigger than me. So. I feel like that's the mark that I want to leave with this more so is being a mirror of myself, but at the same time when I display myself, people see themselves.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? Versus it just being, oh, he makes dope music or his metaphors are dope. It's like, nah, I feel like I'm me at like my highest potential when I'm listening to Troyman. There's a lot of people that have that effect. You know, Kanye had that effect. Probably still does to a lot of people. You know what I'm saying? To a lot of people. He's derailed a lot of people, but I still listen to it. I love Jesus is King. It was a great record. I mean, great album. Jay-Z, Kendrick, Cole, you know, a lot of them fall under that umbrella, and that's what I'm trying to be at.
You still know. Have fun with the records.
I feel like a lot of the times, that's what people lose sight of.
Yeah.
Is you know, they get in, they say, oh, I made this much money off of doing records like this, let's do this again, and, you know, do it that way, versus it's just like when Kendrick dropped Untitled Unmastered, track 7 on there, at the beginning of that song, it's no, he didn't think about it. You could tell he just didn't, life will get you out, dude. Just will get you out. But it's a fun record. You can't tell me, like, when you hear it, it just don't make you want to jump on your bed. And you paying bills, like, you know, like as a grown adult. So I feel like a lot of the times, us as artists, as much as it's about, like, you know, always displaying yourself or, you know, trying to be as politically accurate as possible, sometimes you just gotta turn the fuck up. That's why I love Travis Scott. Mm. I feel like he's in that realm. He's like, nigga, I ain't getting out of this. Like,
it's a rock star.
We're gonna turn up every time y'all see me, you know? And we love it every round because nobody is truly in that. I feel like a person who could've gave him a run for his money if he just stayed consistent was Designer. Designer had that energy. I don't care what nobody says.
Yeah, he does have incredible energy.
His energy is retarded. It's in a good way. Right? I'm not saying there's a bad way to mean that, but he's like, his energy is contagious. But I feel like Travis definitely honed in on that. And it took it to the next level. So I'm trying to just combine what all of these greats are doing and just make like a super villain.
Yeah.
You know, in the best way possible.
And then the acting, using how many movies? I know there was one for sure.
I did. When I was 18, I did an independent movie called Laying My Past to Rest. It was a great movie. It won this independent award and stuff. Outside of that, I did Bolden. It was a jazz movie. I was a dancer in that. And I've done like a lot of different TV shows, like reality shows and acting. I feel like I definitely need to solidify myself more with the music side first, because there's a lot of people who I know as actors and actresses who really want to be musicians, but they're kind of just put in that, well, you're an actor, and, you know, and focus on that. And it's like, I look at the perfect blueprint of this, like on how to do this, like Ludacris's career. Ludacris, when he fucked you up musically, he fucked you up musically.
Yeah, very
and
true.
When he crossed over, and he did it in such a great way where you appreciated both his artistry and his acting resume. And you know, once you go over to that movie check,
it's different,
man. You know, so that's something to truly, you know, truly consider. Because I know once I get the first big one, man, whew, yeah, we can do that again. Hey, y'all want to? That's fine. You know, so, but I definitely want to make sure that people remember my bars first, remember my discography first, and then when I feel like the time is right, I find myself probably going back and forth between the two too. Like, you know, you do a movie, like, all right, we're done with movies for now. Let's get my album.
Yeah.
You know, and then go back and forth. But
from the set to the studio.
Exactly.
That'd be fine.
But to build the proper bridge in between the two, I feel like it's the first goal. You know? Right now, I don't want to distract you guys. We're like, yeah, I got an album coming out and a movie. It's like,
you're gonna be fucked up.
People are like, oh my God, what do I do? You know, so that's what the goal is.
Would you ever shoot your own movies?
I feel like I gotta, as far as like an autobiography.
No, like as in just like a
directing it. Yeah. Definitely, definitely. I feel like I have a lot of crazy ideas like that too, that I've been just kind of sitting on for years, especially now at this time in my career. I can't necessarily just throw ideas out to everybody because motherfuckers will take your shit and run.
Yeah, we ain't got to talk about that now.
No. But just in the sake of just knowing that I definitely have tampered with, like, you know, talking about stuff like that. So.
Wow.
But I just feel like it needs to, the timing of it and the people who I need to know in order to bring that together, I'm pretty sure it's just going to be at a later date.
Yeah.
But the ideas I got are insane. Like, I got this one, I had this past, I used to date strippers. I got this TV show circled around that, but it's gonna take some years to treat it in order. Yeah, it's gonna be dope.
No, that's dope.
Yeah, it's gonna be dope.
Yes, sir. You'll use the top bottom four of rhythm and flow. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank
you. Know what I'm saying?
Congrats.
Thank you.
Cause that's amazing.
That was a dope experience, man. Like, man, it was dope, man. Like, from beginning to end.
He just throw back, he's like,
yeah, like, when you sit back, you think about it, like, where it started. Like, just to keep it real, I was on 106 in Park when I was a teenager, like 17, 18.
And, you know, after that, I maybe did two more competitions. And keep it real, I didn't win. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of talent out there. And, you know, when it's more so selected on who the judges think is right versus mm-hmm. who the people think is right, you know, I fell short. And that's been fine, but I've kind of told myself, I don't want to do competitions no more. Mm-hmm. I don't feel like my artistry should be chopped down like that just, you know, because we're here and we're just going to let these people say who they think is better. Mm-hmm. But when I got that email, I was like, you know what? Fuck it, let's do it.
Fuck it.
Let's do it, right? So I went and did it, you know, and from there, man, just kept climbing. None of it was easy. A lot of people ask me, you know, was it cake for you? It was like, yeah, I mean, I know my bars and stuff. Like, I didn't get starstruck, but just the pressure of when those cameras turn on, this is it, bro. You know, ain't no yeah. do-over. Or, well, we understand. They don't give a shit. If you fuck up, it's better for them.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah. that pressure by yourself, you know, there were points and times, I'm gonna put it this way, like I would pass a challenge, and I'm sure I can speak for a lot of the other contestants that kept advancing. There were points and times I would pass a challenge and I would go up to my room and I would pray.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There were certain times I would pass a challenge, I would go up to my room, I would cry. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There were certain times I would go up there and I'd jump on the bed and I'd call up, I was like, motherfucker, we going to get a drink, let's go. Like,
yeah.
You know, we feel good, but it was just, you know, we experienced all of it, like, pressure either bust pipes or makes diamonds.
Facts.
And then that, you know, definitely let you know who was meant to shine. So
makes sense. Because so, from one challenge, if you pass to the next challenge, it's like tomorrow you got to write this and mm-hmm. memorize it the next day.
That was a challenge too in itself, was when you would be trying so hard to remember something and then by the time you executed it, you had to forget it
yeah.
to remember something else within the turnaround time of 24 to 48 hours. That's where the pressure mentally is like, holy shit, man.
You gotta focus.
Yeah, you know, it's not even about how physically able you are or, you know, how dope your bars are. Like, is your memory straight?
Yeah.
You know, are you clearing your thoughts out? Is it enough room up there for you to remember and, you know, enunciate this shit properly? Because a lot of people folded
mm.
and are talented. Like, don't think that since they folded on that show that they ain't shit. They're actually pretty fucking great. They just couldn't handle pressure.
Yeah.
You know, like, just, that doesn't necessarily mean that, like, prime example, I love Sasha Gohard. I don't think that Sasha Gohard should be limited on the sake of her artistry because she bombed.
Mm.
Yeah.
That's very true.
You know what I'm saying? If you're going to take this, like, the show is great for the platform, but if you're going to take this and be, it's going to be the final verdict on what she's capable of, you lost as the person cutting her off because yeah. she's fire.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I also think it counts towards a lot, like you said, like in those moments where it's like you gotta do this. But a lot of the times, being an artist, like if you pull up on stage and you bomb, mm-hmm. people will hold that against you.
A lot.
You know, just like with the whole thing with other artists that are, you know, canceling tours and mm-hmm. canceling shows and things like that, like. That it's real life. It is pressure.
Like, prime example, like a while ago, Tiffany Haddish,
mm-hmm.
she bombed on stage. Yeah. Is she not funny?
Yeah.
She's funny
she's
as fuck.
Yeah.
yeah.
Should her funniness be determined on that stage, on that show?
That one time, so. Yeah.
But the people are gonna react that
yeah,
way.
You know, that's
which is unfortunate.
You know,
I feel like when you have a repertoire or a rapport of doing dope shit, dope shit, dope shit, dope shit, dope shit, and then there's that one, I don't know.
Yeah.
They not thinking about the shit that you, that's, they not thinking about your consistency. They thinking about that red flag. They're like, when are we gonna see that again? Because
yeah.
it's unorthodox and it's completely against your pattern.
Mm.
So that's what's gonna be talked about. Ultimately, you know, the goal is to not fuck up.
Yeah.
yes.
So period. So.
But then, like, there's artists that are not built for a battle. There's not artists that are built for a cypher.
Yeah.
Like that. So I've seen that kind of challenge through other people. So.
And I was appreciative of that.
Mm-hmm.
I was appreciative of that because a lot of the times, what that competition showed you is, you think you can do hip hop fully?
Mm-hmm.
You're gonna have to exceed
in all aspects.
Categories.
Yeah.
Not only that. Yeah. Consistently,
yeah.
which is it's not just okay, do this, good job, see you in 2 weeks, come back, do this part. No, like, you're gonna have to be able to handle the pressure of that, either conquer or fail, and keep moving, you know. And I feel like a lot of the times, there's with hip hop, it's such a
it's such a beautiful culture because of how diverse it is. There's no blueprint on this shit. Nobody's told us, this is how you make a hip hop record. This is what the chorus is supposed to sound like. This is it. So, but now with this show, I feel like with the challenges at least, you're able to see the true ins and outs of what most artists, if not all, go through on becoming a great artist. Kendrick is not a battle rapper. Has he battled?
Yes.
Yeah.
J. Cole is not a battle rapper. Has he battled? Yeah. You know, have you people done cyphers? Of course. Like, music videos, that's something that you truly gonna have to go crazy on if you
want to be an artist. And master, yeah.
You know, working with hip producers, everybody's gonna have to do that. Like, this is like, it was a rap Olympics.
That's how it was, a rap Olympics.
You want the goal, let's see your agility. Let's see your stamina. And you know,
what was your favorite challenge?
My favorite challenge, the one that I knew I was not going home on, was the music video challenge.
Yeah.
To be honest with you,
you're super creative.
In retrospect, I'm gonna keep it real with you. No, Cap, is this her calling me?
Oh, hey, London.
Oh, wow. Yeah, what's her calling me? What, is she here? Are you in Rhode Island? Huh. I'm in an interview. Say hey.
Hey, how are you?
Hey. What up, though? Hey, girl.
You gotta say hi to the camera.
Hey, say it to the camera, London.
Hey.
That's
crazy.
And look, I will call you. Listen, do your thing.
Wait. Yo, you look great.
You look great, girl.
What
I'm saying? Yo, I'm trying to be like you when I grow up. Shut up.
I love you, bro.
Love you too. I'm gonna call you back in a minute.
All right,
bye. That's my nigga, man.
Hey, that was dope.
That was really dope.
One thing I could definitely say from the show that I'm truly appreciative of, too, was the relationships. We wasn't expecting that. You go into competitions expecting to chew motherfuckers.
And
to walk in there and it was like, yo, like, D-Smoke is a true big brother. Like, Flawless is like my dog. Like, you know what I'm saying? Same with London, same with Caleb, Sam, Ali. Really, from the top, you know, from the top seven on, everybody was like, yo, this is a forever thing.
You know,
like,
yeah.
That's dope. And you guys got matching tattoos from
The top four did. That's when they gave us a break, and we were just able to truly sit and reflect for like a day. We went out, we had like a nice dinner, you know, we took the town. And we just knew, like, at that point, like, our lives are gonna change. Nobody around us knew in the moment. You know, so we're looking at like, yo, we normal as fuck right now. You know, it's just gonna change and like we're gonna be super appreciative of it. So, but we was walking past this tattoo spot, I was like, yo, what's up? Y'all really with this shit? And D-Smoke was like, I love y'all. I love y'all that much.
I love y'all that much. Yeah.
Paulus was like, I'm with it. Y'all my niggas, I'm with it.
I love it.
So, and then, you know, once we convinced the queen, once the queen was like, all in favor, say aye. We raised our
hands. Yeah.
And we went in there and we got our stripes, man. It was dope.
That's what's up.
It was super dope.
Shit, where were we? Oh, we're talking about the video, the music video.
The music video challenge. I, ironically, in retrospect, I knew I was not gonna go home on that challenge, but that was like my weakest point as an artist. Before, I could fuck you up audio-wise, but visuals, I was doing everything myself. I was editing my own videos. I would just tell my bro to press record. And so, I can't lie, I was worried about it, you know? Yeah. I gave him the idea. I felt like the idea I almost had to overcompensate with, like, yeah, we need good lights, something active. I like skating. Skating lights. T.I. Atlanta, this is working. Okay, Cascade.
ATM.
And from the rest, what you mean?
I'm
this
having
easy breezy at this point. All I gotta do is rap, you know, once they put it together. Shout out to the director too, LCRS, Robotics of Future. He did No Games or No Guidance by Drake and Chris Brown. Yeah. He did that video. Exceptional team over there.
That is my favorite fucking song.
They so lit.
So shout out to you because your video is fire.
And my bro Josh Smith. My bro Josh Smith is the choreographer for that video.
That is
he
hella dope.
He dances for Chris Brown. Oh, wow. So I had multiple people that I knew from separate avenues kind of came together on that Chris Brown project, which was pretty lit. It was a great video.
Wow, yeah.
That's dope. So yeah, that was your strongest thing you...
Strongest, I could definitely say. One of the most nervous times.
audition was cake. Cypher was cake.
Cypher was cake.
Cypher was cake. Battle, I can't lie. The battle had me nervous, but it wasn't the most nervous.
Yeah.
The battle didn't have me nervous because of the competition. I feel like it was more so nervous because I knew that a lot of my bars do this.
It's not for everybody because not everybody's intelligent.
What I loved about it was, you know, in the sake of the deciding verdict, it did come down to execution and skill, which ultimately I exceeded in.
Yeah.
Because Jacob did have some lit shit. Mm-hmm. I love Jacob to death. He has some dope bars. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But in the sake of how you package it all together, it's like, okay, I like to put it like this. I told my bro this the other day. Do you appreciate a gift more actually gift wrapped, or when you could just see that the gift wrap paper is just like around the gift? Like, so do you appreciate the box?
Yeah.
Or do, like, if I gift you a basketball and you see that I just
when it's wrapped, yeah.
Yeah.
Which one would you appreciate more? Exactly. It's just more presentable.
Yeah.
You know.
I guess, yeah.
Even at that point, you wouldn't wrap a ball.
Yeah, no. I feel what you're saying.
I'll be having weird metaphors sometimes. Oh,
yeah. Sometimes they're good.
Maybe a little deep sometimes.
Yeah, I get it.
So how do you feel now?
I feel like the hard part is really on. Fame and success are two different things.
Mm.
Clout and, you know, success are two different things. Yep. So I have 500,000 followers. Whoop-dee-doo. You know what I'm saying? At the end of the day, you know, I'm still in my humble apartment. You know, I'm looking to make these followers into devout fans. Anybody can follow you. I follow a lot of people that I might not even necessarily fully agree with half the time.
Yeah.
A follower is not going to help them pay their bills, or, you know, or truly turning these followers into fans. And I feel like that's the next goal, which is the hard part. Because once you become self-sufficient, and, you know, you're running off of, you know, money that you've made, and it truly comes on to your work ethic and how much you put into it every day, you know?
Have those followers been transitioning into fans?
I love them.
Yeah.
I couldn't ask for better supporters. I feel like they, at this point, all I asked for from God was, just give me the people that believe. Just give me the people who listen. And sure enough, I didn't win this competition. I didn't win $250,000. But I got what the fuck I asked for. You know what I'm saying? It's like, oh, you. I was ready. I was settling. I was, God, you give me 100,000 followers, I know what to do. And he gave me 5.
Yeah.
So I'm like, oh, you a show out. Okay. I got you. So now at this point, I just really need them to digest what I have to say. If they love to turn up, we're not going to have no problem with this journey. The conversion from turning them into followers into fans has been real. I've been, you know, expressing myself as my personality wise. They love the merch that I drop. The quality that they think from that is dope. The exclusivity of it is dope.
Lyrical sensibility.
I love that shit. I love that shit. Yeah, it's a dope. My dad helped me with that bar.
Yeah.
He was drunk one day. I was in the bed, bro. I was knocked out. He was like, son, he was listening to one of my records that I had sent him that's going to be coming out.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, son, you are fucking incredible. Let me tell you something. No, let me tell you something. I don't like hip hop. I don't listen to shit. Like, this is just trash. But this should be on the fucking radio. And he was like, you've been lyrical since a kid, man. You've been lyrical since a feet. You've been lyrical since your umbilical.
Bitch, I've been lyrical since umbilical.
And I was like, you say that again? You just say that one more time. You've been lyrical since umbilical. I gotta write that down. And, you know, I wrote it down months before the show, you know? And something about it, I was in the studio with Tay Keith, and he had called me. He's like, what you doing, man? I was like, I'm in the studio with Tay Keith. He's like, yo, this is super dope. All right, call me later. And just talking to him, he didn't say anything about that line. I got on the phone with him, got off, and I remembered the line. I was like, I need this. Bitch, I've been lyrical since lyrical. It's just, you know, and from there it fit. And the reason why I like it so much is because we live in such a simple time of hip hop, and to make a motherfucker rhyme with umbilical is
difficult.
Fetched. It's pretty crazy, so.
And it was dope how the beat dropped in that part, so.
Yeah, the execution.
Made a statement, so it's dope that you you run with that joint.
The execution of that record was everything. Shout out to Tay Keith, man.
Tay Keith, fuck that.
No, I'm telling you, like, Tay Keith, I didn't win $250,000, but I could secure a much bigger bag than that with this Tay Keith project.
So talk to us a little bit about, you said that you have the song coming up, mm-hmm. and it's going to be on a new project. So talk to us a little bit about that.
I have a project coming out. It was originally titled Take Your Woke Ass to Sleep.
Yeah.
But you know, just due to us wanting to reach more of a universal market and ass kind of being a hindrance of that, I changed it to Insomniac.
Mm-hmm.
It's basically my journey on ignorance to enlightenment while battling sleep deprivation.
Mm.
So I like to think a lot of the times I don't sleep. My mind is racing. When I say I don't sleep, I do sleep, but it's very minimal. Like, I go to bed at 2 and, you know, turn around and wake up at 6, 7. Like, I mean, like...
Wide awake?
Like, yeah, just eyes open. Like,
yeah.
We're up, what are we doing? Shower, you know, smoke. It's just the normal stuff. But I can never sleep past 8 o'clock.
I wish. I'm up at 1, too.
I'm just, my mind is always racing with, you know, thinking about what I need to be doing or what I could have done better. But, yeah. It's called Insomniac. It's super short. I'm gonna just call it a project for right now.
Yeah.
It's not an album. I definitely can assure you that, because the album I'm working on is nuts. Yeah, but it's coming out top of the year. I won't say when, but just know when I drop it, you got a short amount of time, because shortly after that, Tay Keith's coming.
Yeah.
Which is what a lot of people have been waiting for. And I don't want to keep them waiting too long. I definitely want to hit them while the iron's hot with that one, and I just feel like the proper preparation of it will prevent the poor performance. So I say late 2020.
Mm. Late 2020.
Take Keith.
Nice.
I ain't tell nobody else that either.
A plug exclusive.
Plug exclusive.
We got the London FaceTime, and we got the Tay Keith exclusive.
Yeah, that was not.
What a blessed Thursday.
Yeah, I'm telling you, that was not prescriptive. Y'all energy definitely called for that.
Thank you.
I appreciate y'all.
Oh, man.
Well, we appreciate you.
Definitely.
For real. Thank you, guys.
Oh, man. What's one piece of advice you get? Give an upcoming artist or entrepreneur or anyone?
I find myself giving myself this advice every day. Hire who you feel like is necessary to help you go to the next level. But as far as the artistry, do what the fuck you want to do, man. I feel like a lot of these times people, like, they want you to make a, you know, or take your artistry in a certain direction where they feel like you'll be successful. Success is really determined by the person who is doing the work.
So, yeah.
Right now, I love the Grammys. I love the Recording Academy. As much as a lot of people have made that a goal, it is a goal of mine too, but I haven't, like, I'm not gonna conform my art
to their standards.
To satisfy you for that. Meaning, that is a Grammy for me, is not conforming with who I am for anybody or any, you know. And if I get it, guess what? I'm gonna get it being myself.
Yeah.
Ultimately.
And it means so much more.
It's gonna be, yo, what? Y'all fuck with me being me and gave me this? Yeah, that's lit. You know what I'm saying? Versus me, like, okay, I made this within attempts of trying to do this. And then, you know, usually when artists do that, they don't get the recognition they want. It's like, yo, I'm trying to get a Grammy off this. It's like, this? No. You're pissed off, you know, because you just spent all this time, you know, and then you know, fuck the Grammys and shit because you pissed. You know, it's like, don't try in the first place. Just don't try. How about you just try to be the best artist that you can ever be for you? And if they fuck with it, they fuck with it, you know? So I feel like that's, if you take any advice on doing this shit, don't let these award shows and shit kind of misguide you, or success or money in general. If that's what you're in it for, cool. There's lanes for it. But, you know, if you got some substance, stick to it. And don't let nobody take you away from it.
Yeah.
Because they will.
They really do.
They will.
It's a plug exclusive, man. Once again, thank you for pulling up on. Well, we pulled up on you.
Yeah, we pulled.
Yeah, this pulled up.
Yeah, man. We have to pull up.
Knowing Merv ass, don't be doing no crazy shit with this
back
music.
Here.
We probably flying and shit. Jets going past us and shit. Right. Doing crazy shit.
You know what I mean?
Shout out to Red Eye Movies.
Yes, sir.
Shout out to Rem. Yeah, man. Appreciate you guys, man. I fucks with the plug for real.
Hey,
I fucks with the plug.
Josh and Bruce.
Jam. I call him Jam.
You know what I mean?
Call him Jam.
I'm about to get out of here. Once again, I am Go DJ.
It's your girl, Maddie D.
Troyman.
And this is the plug. Can you be my plug?